Advent is a time of preparation for the coming of our Lord. And we prepare for Christ's coming in three different ways. First, we prepare for the celebration of the anniversary of his first coming, when he became incarnate and born to the Virgin Mary in Bethlehem in a stable. God humbled himself and became human, and we rejoice on this day. Second, we prepare for his coming into our hearts and into our lives through the grace and nourishment of the sacraments, especially by receiving the sacrament of reconciliation and the Eucharist. And third, we prepare for Christ's second coming at the end of time, when he comes to judge the living and the dead. And we prepare by living in a way that is acceptable to our Lord, by observing his church's and scripture's guidance. Our preparations during this sacred time of Advent should have all three of our Lord's comings in mind, to faithfully and devoutly prepare our souls to receive Christ worthily and willingly. Today we celebrate the third Sunday of Advent, and it's a special day with a special theme. The third Sunday in Advent on the liturgical calendar is called Gaudete Sunday. Gaudete is a Latin word meaning rejoice, and the theme for Gaudete Sunday is joy. This theme is reflected in the vestments that Father Matthew is wearing today. Many call the color pink, but Father Matthew preferably likes to call them rose-colored. Sounds a little more manly, I think. During the other three Sundays of Advent, the Church stresses emphasizes the penitential and preparatory nature of Advent, vigilantly awaiting and readying ourselves for the coming of our Lord. But on Gaudete Sunday, we take a break from the Lenten-like atmosphere and joyfully celebrate the coming of our Lord and emphasize the joyful realization of what our Lord taking on flesh means for each and every one of us personally. The clergy shed their purple vestments for more joyful rose-colored ones, and the music at Mass is a little more upbeat and celebratory, less somber. And Gaudete Sunday is a day to celebrate and joyfully reflect on Christ's coming while we still prepare our hearts and minds to encounter him in a very special way on Christmas. When Advent comes every year, I often think of when I was a kid, or even now as an adult, when we have company over, especially for bigger celebrations like Christmas or Easter or baptism or a birthday party. We prepare for the special people that were invited to come over by readying our house. I remember all the cleaning of the house we would do. I would always say, and still do, we should wait and clean when the company is gone. That's when the house really is going to need the cleaning. But my words always and still do fall on deaf ears. We would clean every inch of the house. Sometimes we would even clean under the stove or behind the refrigerator, places you would neglect when doing ordinary, regular cleaning. This was special. We were having special people over, and we wanted to make a good impression on them. My thought when I was a kid was that we didn't want them to know that we lived like pigs. We wanted coming over to our home to be a special time for them. Whether I realized it or not back then, I do now, that we did all the cleaning and all that preparation out of love, because we wanted them to know that they were welcome when they came to our house. And this is why we have Advent, to look at every nook and cranny of our lives and see what needs work to prepare for the special person we call our Savior, so he knows he is loved and that he is welcome in our hearts and in our lives, and to prepare for his coming joyfully. Paul's second letter to the Thessalonians tells us how we should prepare ourselves for the Lord's coming. Again, his coming in the three specific ways I spoke about earlier. His coming into the world, into our hearts, and at the end of time. Paul says, "Brothers and sisters, rejoice always. Pray without ceasing. In all circumstances, give thanks." He doesn't say rejoice sometimes, increase your prayer time, or give thanks when good things come your way. No, he says always, without ceasing, and in all circumstances. Now, for most of us, this is really hard to understand. But Paul says, rejoice always. Does that mean when you lose a loved one, we should be happy about it? And when something horrible happens to us, we should celebrate? I don't think so. For Paul, Jesus' coming and death and resurrection changed everything for him and for the world. Jesus' becoming incarnate has changed the usual way of thinking, and his death and resurrection have given us hope beyond all human imagination. If you look at Paul's life, for example, before he encountered Christ, he was giving 110% for the opposition of Christianity, persecuting and even killing Christians. And after he encountered Christ in the dramatic way he did, and after he allowed Christ into his heart and realized what Christ's death and resurrection meant for him and for all of humanity, he gave 150% effort in the totally opposite direction for the cause of Christ and for his church. What Paul is saying when he says to rejoice always, I think he means that Jesus has defeated and overcome everything in this world. He has conquered death. The unconquerable has been conquered. What it doesn't mean is that we will be without trials or struggles or hardships. And in spite of the ugliness we encounter in this world, Christ has given us the hope to overcome everything with his help by allowing him into our hearts and our lives. And in that, we should rejoice always. When Paul says, pray without ceasing, does he mean to sit in prayer every minute of the day and not work or take care of your children or spend time with your spouse? I don't think so. What he means is to live your life entirely as a prayer to his Father. Pray in all circumstances. When you go to work in the morning, say, Lord, be with me this day, and may all I do glorify you. And when you're disciplining your children, say, Lord, I offer my children back to you for your service, and may you guide me in how I raise them so that they will grow up and serve you. And pray that God will be with you and help you in all that you do, to pray without ceasing. Paul says, in all circumstances, give thanks. Does that mean if our house burns down, we should be thankful for it? I don't think so. What it means is that Christ has come into this world to be with us, and he promised to be with us always. He became human and had to endure the worst that this world has to offer. In all circumstances, he walks with us in all our trials, in all our struggles. We just have to be aware of it and be thankful for his grace. I was talking to someone the other day, and we were discussing preparing for when people come over to your home. And I shared this story with them. When we were living in Alexandria, we were friends with a gal I worked with and her husband, and they invited us over for supper one evening and to play some cards. We went over there to their house, and when we got there, I was giving her grief on how clean her house was, that she must have been cleaning all day. I even looked in her oven to make sure it was cleaned in there, and her eyes got as big as saucers when I opened the door. She had put all her dirty dishes in the oven because she did not have time to wash them. Back then, everyone didn't have dishwashers. We all laughed about it, but she was totally embarrassed. As we prepare for Advent, for the coming of our Lord, may we not be embarrassed for not preparing as we should. May our dishes all be clean and our hearts be completely open to encounter the Savior of the world. Paul writes in the second reading, "May the God of peace make you perfectly holy, and may you entirely, spirit, soul, and body, be preserved blameless for the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. For the one who calls you is faithful, and he will accomplish it." Amen.